إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله جل وعلا، وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. ثم أما بعد، second talk إن شاء الله تعالى of today is about a topic that is very important for all of us. That's what is بيان ضوابط العبادة الصحيحة. It's pertaining to things that we have to know and we should all have knowledge of, because our ibadah, our worship depends on this, on these things. For our worship to be correct, we have to know these things and check our ibadah, check our worship based on these points, insha'Allah ta'ala. And we should always remember that the happiness in this life and in the hereafter lays in fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and obeying His orders. This was going to enable us to be happy in this life and yet in the hereafter. فَعْلَمُوا عِبَادَ اللَّهِ أَنَّ اللَّهَ خَلَقَ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ لِعِبَادَتِهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala خَلَقَ الْجِنَّ والإنس لعبادته، كما قال تعالى في سورة الذاريات: وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون. And we should always remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created the jinn and the human beings so they can worship Him alone, for His worship alone. That's the purpose behind the creation. The proof is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah 51, Ayah 56, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, "And I did not create the jinn and the human beings except that they should worship me." وَفِي ذَلِكَ شَرَفُهُمْ وَعِزُّهُمْ وَسَعَادَتُهُمْ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ لِأَنَّهُمْ بِحَاجَةٍ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ وَلَا غِنَى لَهُمْ عَنْهُ طَرْفَ عَيْنٍ. And if the human beings and the jinn, they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they fulfill this obligation and they worship their Lord alone, in that their honor, their might and their happiness in this life and the hereafter. That's because we human beings and the jinn as well, we're constantly in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help and assistance and aid. We cannot do without Allah's aid and assistance, not even for the blink of an eye. وَهُوَ اللَّهُ غَنِيٌّ عَنْهُمْ وَعَنْ عِبَادَتِهِمْ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is self-sufficient. He's not in need for the jinns, or nor for the human beings. Nor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in need for their worship. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Az-Zumar, Ayah 7, إن تكفروا فإن الله غني عنكم. إن تكفروا فإن الله غني عنكم. If you disbelieve, then verily Allah is not in need of you. If you disbelieve, then verily Allah is not in need of you. وقال تعالى في سورة إبراهيم وقال موسى إن تكفروا أنتم ومن في الأرض جميعا فإن الله لغني حميد. And Musa, Moses said, if you disbelieve, you and all on earth together. He said to his people, he said to them, if you disbelieve, you and all on earth together, then verily Allah is rich, free of all needs, owner of all praise. Owner of all praise. So since we mentioned the ibadah, this ibadah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us to worship Him alone. خلقنا لعبادته وحده. خلقنا الله لعبادته. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the purpose. This is why we're here on earth. Mainly we're here to fulfill this responsibility, which is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone with no partners. So what is this worship? What is this worship, this word, this ibadah that is so important? That is the purpose why we're here. Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us. So we should know what it is. Shaykh al-Fawzan hafidahu Allah ta'ala said, العبادة هي التقرب إلى الله تعالى بما شرعه من الأعمال والأقوال الظاهرة والباطنة. Of course this ibadah has many meanings. Different scholars through the time, they bring many meanings and actually definitions, different definitions to this word al-ibadah, worship. Sheikh here, he chose this one, which is simple for us, and general and comprehensive as well. He said, al-ibadah, worship, هي التقرب إلى الله تعالى, is to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by the way of that which Allah has legislated. Not to just to get closer to Allah in any way. No, to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by the way of that which He, Allah, legislated from actions and statements. Whether those who are manifested or those who are hidden. So that's the ibadah, as the Shaykh al-Fawzan, hafidhahu wa ta'ala, chose this definition, said, is to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but remember it's very important, with that which Allah has legislated. With that which Allah has legislated from statements, from actions and statements, those who are openly manifested by us, or those that we do in secret. وهي حق لله على خلقه. وهي حق لله على خلقه. Next point we have to know is that this ibadah, this worship, it is the right of Allah upon His servants. It is the right of Allah upon His servants. As it occurs in the hadith of Mu'ad, رضي الله عنه, when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said to him, يا معاد, أتدري ما حق الله على العباد؟ O Mu'ad, do you know the right that Allah has upon His servant? Right hand. Do you know the right that Allah has upon His servant? Mu'ad said, Allah wa Rasuluhu a'lam. Allah and His Messenger know best. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, أن يعبدوه ولا يشركوا به شيئا. That the right that Allah has upon His servant, that they should worship Him alone, and they do not set up rivals with Him in worship. So that is very important to know that this worship is a right that belongs to Allah only. To no angels, shouldn't be devoted to no close angels, to no messenger or prophet, no human beings, no trees, no nothing, no stones, no rocks, no moon, no sun. This is a right that is deserving for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. وَفَائِدَتُهَا تَعُودُ عَلَيْهِمْ. And yet, the benefit of this worship doesn't go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It goes back to us. Yet this is a right for Allah, but we the one that benefit from it. And then the Shaykh Ibn this Pay attention now because this is very alhamdulillah. There's a lot of information in this talk, inshallah, very lot of information. The Shaykh has said, فَمَنْ أَبَى أَنْ يَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ فَهُوْ مُسْتَكْبِرُ. So, since this is the case, and that the worship is the right of Allah upon His servants, He created us only to worship Him alone, and that this worship, we're the one that benefits from. He says, so therefore, whoever refuses to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is an arrogant. That's the first person. So therefore, the one who refused and abstained from worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the person who is arrogant. وَمَنْ عَبَدَ اللَّهَ وَعَبَدَ مَعَهُ غَيْرُهُ فَهُوَ مُشْرِكٌ. The second point here, as for the one who worship Allah. Look at the first point, is a person who refused to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's an arrogant. The second category is a person, or those persons who, but he associates partners with him in worship. That's a mushrik, a polytheist. Number three, وَمَنْ عَبَدَ اللَّهَ وَحْدَهُ بِغَيْرِ مَا شَرَعَ فَهُ مُبْتَدِعُ. And whoever worship Allah alone, he don't set up no rivals with Allah. This is the third category. He worship Allah alone. He knows that Allah is the only one to be worshipped. And that the ibadah, the worship is the right for Allah alone. So therefore he does not ascribe to Allah partners. But this person's problem is that he worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but not based on that which Allah has legislated. Remember the definition of the ibadah is to get closer to Allah, not to Allah and Jibreel, to Allah alone, not to Allah and Isa, Jesus, not to Allah and the sun and the moon, la. The definition is very important to pay attention to the wording of the definition. Because it has a connection with the point we're mentioning. Because the ibadah was to worship Allah alone, to get closer to Allah alone, by that which Allah has legislated. But now in the third category, this is a person who yet worship Allah alone, but not based on that which Allah has legislated. This is an innovator. This is how you know an innovator. So don't be fooled by, oh, I worship Allah alone, akhi. Yeah, but based on what? Based on that which Allah legislated, or based on some innovative things and ways and manners? So whoever worship Allah alone, and but not based on that which Allah has legislated, he is a person who is an innovator. And four and lastly, وَمَنْ عَبَدَ اللَّهَ وَحْدَهُ بِمَا شَرَعَ فَهُوَ الْمُؤْمِنُ الْمُوَحِّدُ. And whoever worship Allah alone, based on what Allah has legislated, this is the true believer who is upon Tawheed. This is the true believer who is upon Islamic monotheism. So this is four categories of people when it comes to ibadah. It's very important to know them, it's very important to remember this. The first is the person who refused to worship Allah. That's an arrogance. The second one is a person who worship Allah, yes, he has no problem, he worship Allah, but he sets up rivals with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship. This is a mushrik, a polytheist, committed shirk. And the third person is a person who worship Allah alone, does not ascribe to him any partners, but not based on what Allah has legislated. That's the innovator, mubtadi'. That's the innovator. And the fourth one is a person who worship Allah alone and following the legislation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the true believer who is upon Islamic monotheism. The Shaykh said, وَلَمَّا كَانَ الْعِبَادُ فِي ضَرُورَةٍ إِلَى الْعِبَادَةِ وَلَا يُمْكِنُهُمْ أَنْ يَعْرِفُوا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ حَقِيقَتَهَا الَّتِي تُرْضِي اللَّهَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتُوَافِقْ دِينَهُ لَمْ يَكِلْهُمْ إِلَى أَنفُسِهِمْ. He says, since the servants, they need this ibadah, they need this worship. It's important for us, this ibadah, this worship, because of the results that carries
And since the human beings, they won't be able to know the reality of this ibadah. Just randomly, they won't be on a path that earned them the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and therefore match that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated. They cannot just know these things on their own by them pondering and reflecting. But from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He didn't leave them for their own selves to try to ponder and reflect how we're going to please Allah. But from His mercy, أَرْسَلَ إِلَيْهِمُ الرُّسُلُ وَأَنْزَلُ الْكُتُبُ لِبَيَانِ حَقِيقَةِ تِلْكَ الْعِبَادَةِ. From Allah's mercy upon His servants and upon all of us, He has sent to us messengers. Yes, He commanded us to worship Him alone, but He didn't leave it for any one of us to just try to figure out what is the best way to worship Allah and to please Allah. لا. He sent to us messengers, and He sent to us books. Allah sent messengers to the time and sent books. And the last messenger is Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم to all mankind. And the last book was the Quran, the speech of Allah, which is not created. So He has sent messengers and books so that He made clear for them the reality of this ibadah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will explain in details what is this ibadah and how the people, what they should do and they shouldn't do, so they can carry this ibadah and this responsibility. The proof to that is, first of all, the ayah 36 in Surah Al-Nahl, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ. Allah said, indeed we have sent amongst every nation a messenger to His people proclaiming, worship Allah alone and avoid the ta'ghut, and avoid the false deities. The second proof is the ayah 25 in Surah Al-Anbiya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَعْبُدُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, there is not a single messenger that came before you except that we reveal to him that there is no one worthy of worship except me, so therefore worship me. So here, barakallahu fikum, you see from this ayat that the risala, the message of all the messengers and the prophets was one. Every single one of them called his people to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore you see this is a clear refutation to the Christians who they claim that Jesus called them to worship Him and His mother. Amongst many other ayahs that explains this point of aqidah, that is very important to know, that all the messengers and the prophets, they were sent with one message. All of them. Different times, different eras, but one message to call the people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As one of the brothers from Britain, he has this tape, I don't know if you know about it, tape called Moses, Jesus, Muhammad, Three Men, One Mission. You heard of it before? So their mission was one, is to call the people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قال فمن حاد عما بينته الرسل ونزلت به الكتب من عبادة الله وعبد الله بما يملي عليه ذوقه وما تهواه نفسه وما زينته له شياطين الإنس والجن فقد ضل عن سبيل الله ولم تكن عبادته في الحقيقة عبادة لله بل هي عبادة لهواه. The Sheikh Fawzan said, so whoever turns away from that which the messengers they made clear. And when we said it like this, meaning the people of Nuh who turns away from what Nuh explained to them. The people of Salih, they turned away from what Salih made clear for them. The people of Musa, those who turned away from the teachings of Musa. The people of Isa, Jesus, alayhi salam, the son of Mary, those in his time who turned away from the teaching of Isa. But after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we all know that the only religion is Islam. And the only prophet that should be followed is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So also those people now who they choose to stay away from that which the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has made clear, and they stay away from, they took on another path other than the path of the messengers and the path that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made clear for us in the books He has sent. Instead to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based on that which He came in those books, and He came under the tongue of the messengers that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent, and they just follow that which looks good to them, that which they think is right to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with, and following their desires, following what their nafs and what their souls telling them to do, and plus that which the shayateen has made beautiful to them, because the shayateen, the devils, they have a hand in this as well. They beautify to the people their actions. This is a person who went astray, no doubt. A person like this, he's astray. He's astray in a plain error. And this is a person, his ibadah, yes, he's worshipping, people pray. Yes, this is a reality. There's a lot of Muslims, millions, they pray. They make hajj, they fast. But since they're not following that which he came in the book of Allah and the sunnah of the Messenger of Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, yes, they pray. They make wudu, they make hajj. They do this and do, they say, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. But since they follow on their desires, they're not following the legislation. So, yes, they have a worship, but in reality, that worship is not for Allah. Rather, they worship in their own desires. Is this point understood? Huh? Clear? Because you gotta be understand, this is the minhaj. Not everybody who pray, he's praying for Allah. Not everybody who make a hajj, he made it for Allah. Not everybody who said, La ilaha illallah, means that's the only thing he said. There is a lot of Muslims, who perhaps you may not see it here, but in the Muslim countries, there is Muslims by millions. They say, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, but then they go to a grave of a dead person and say, oh, give me children, I don't have no children. Muslims, who've been to Hajj here? Nobody. You've been to Hajj? I guess you don't have passports, right? Get your passports, akhi, and get your money. You gotta make hajj. InshaAllah, try to. But once you go there, you're gonna see people, instead to ask Allah, they ask in the Kaaba. Shirk. Instead to ask Allah, they ask in who? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are people, they, if you ask them, you're a Muslim or a Christian, he get offended. What kind of question, akhi? Don't you see? I'm here. Don't you see my thawb, my lahya? But the action, are they for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So this is very important to understand, ya ibad Allah. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Qasas, ayah 50, وَمَنْ أَضَلُّ مِمَّنْ اتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ بِغَيْرِ هُدًى مِنَ اللَّهِ. And who is more astray than one who follows his own lust without guidance from Allah? And who is more astray than one who follows his own lust without guidance from Allah? شيخ الفوزان said, وَهَذَا الْجِنْسُ كَثِيرٌ فِي الْبَشَرِ وَفِي طَلِيعَتِهِمَ النَّصَارَ وَمَنْ ضَلَّ مِنْ فِرَقَ هَذِي الْأُمَّةِ. He said, this example here are many among the human beings. People like this, who worship Allah based on this pattern, are many amongst the human beings. And in the top of the list, the Christians. The Christians who claim they worship the Lord, but then look how they do it. They stay away from, they went astray. And not just the Christian, the Shaykh he said, and anybody from this ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not just the Christian, and anybody from this ummah who they follow the pattern of the Christians. Yes, they worship the Lord, they worship Allah, but then they didn't follow the pattern, the path that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has clearly said in his book and in the sunnah of his messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فإنهم اختطوا لأنفسهم خطة في العبادة مخالفة لما شرعه الله في كثير من شعاراتهم. Why they are wrong? and where they went wrong. Where they went wrong. Because instead to stick to the teachings of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ and that which the Sahaba were upon, Ridwanullah alayhim, they invented a new method, a new way to worship Allah. That's when they were wrong. That's when they were wrong. Instead to stick to the manhaj of the Prophet ﷺ, that which his companions they were upon, no. They put that to the side and they invented a new ways and new methods to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which is in opposition to that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated. Which is in opposition, totally in the opposite of that which Allah has legislated. And this is manifested in many of their ibadahs and their actions and their statements. قال وهذا يتضح ببيان حقيقة العبادة التي شرعها الله على لسان رسوله ليتبين أن كل ما خالفها فهو باطل وإن زعم من أتى به أنه يقربه إلى الله فهو يبعده عن الله. الله أكبر. And this the Sheikh mentioned this very important point. He said but not everybody will be able to say that yes they Muslims and they worship Allah but actually they astray. Actually, they are far away from the correct ibadah. The only people that will be able to make the difference are those who they know the true meanings and the true definition of ibadah. They're the only one. This is blood because I know its blood form. I know the color. Somebody who don't know his colors, he can't say anything. Or even if he doesn't say nothing, if somebody say, that's red. He's going to say, yeah, that's red. Especially if the person who say red is someone who he has a lot of respect for. He's his imam, or he's his father, or his mother, a figure in his life. See? That's why people, they go astray. He's simply asking. I just give the example of the phone. We all know this phone is black, right? Somebody has doubt? Somebody here in this room has doubt? Ajibu, answer. What color is it? Black. Okay. We bring someone somewhere don't know his colors. And we say to him, what color is this? Why he thinking somebody of us say red. He's gonna say, yeah, I was gonna say that. It's red. Yeah, that's what it is. And his certainty becomes so strong based on this information where he come from. If he come, like I say, for someone who is a figure in his life, yes, he's most definitely that this phone is red. Even though for all of us it is black. That's why the people of innovation. That's why you have to make the difference between there is the people who call to innovation, they innovators, but there is their followers who don't know. They just say the brother imam said it. So, does it happen to you? Sometimes you see someone, a layman, Muslim, who's worshiping Allah in a certain way, praying in a certain way, making dua in a certain way. And you gotta come and say to him, yeah, akhi, this is not right. He's gonna say, no. Why, akhi? You ask them why? He said, because the brother imam said it. The brother imam. Why? Because the imam is a figure in his life. Or he may say, my father, or he say, my whole tribe, akhi. He may say to you, my whole country. Somebody may come from a Muslim country in abroad to America, and he's upon innovation, and this is common. This is not no Chinese here. We know these things. We experience these things. We wear upon things like this, and Allah guides us, alhamdulillah, to the sunnah. May Allah keep us firm upon it, ameen. And you ask that person, why are you doing it? He's going to say, because this is the right thing. What if you prove? You need no proof. Why? Because my whole country they are upon this. You think you an American, you know better than my whole country? Are we born Muslims? I born a Muslim, you gotta teach me something? No. This is arrogance. You remember the point, the first one? The one who refuses to submit to the legislation of Allah, he's an arrogant. This is a person who refused. This is the haq come to him. And he refuses. So that's why we have to pay attention to make the difference when it comes to this, to these matters. So only those people who they know the correct ibadah, the correct meaning of worship and definition, they're the ones they're going to be able to know the opposite of the ibadah. But if we don't know, everything is going to be the same for us. Everything. Whatever they're going to, the brother imam bring on Jumu'ah, we're going to take it and go and worship Allah upon it. Whatever a brother, just because he's an Arab, he has a long beard, he's a famous, his name is listed all over the tapes and internet, well, he must be right, Akhi Yara. Drink with your right hand, brother. Right hand, right? That's not the case. If you're going to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're going to worship Allah based on what Allah legislated. Not just based on what the imam said, not just based on what the brother, because he has a longer beard than you on the toe, has said. And by the way, I'm not expecting from all of you here, I'm not expecting from you, all of you here, to just take whatever I'm saying. I'm not expecting from you to just say, oh, brother Muhammad is here, and whatever I'm saying. I want you to be sharp. I want you to wake up. If you're dizzy, go make wudu and come back. I want you to be sharp and vigilant. Pay attention to every word and everything I'm saying. And if I'm wrong, correct me. This is the minhaj I want Allah. Don't say, oh yeah, brother so-and-so, he must be, yeah, he's a brother. He's a student of knowledge. I'm not a student of knowledge, that's the first thing. And the second thing, this is deen. As Muhammad ibn Sirin, rahimahullah ta'ala, from the Imam of al-Tabi'in said, إِنَّ هَذَا الْعِلْمَ دِينٌ فَانْظُرُوا عَمَّنْ تَأْخُذُونَ دِينَكُمْ. This knowledge that we study in here is the deen, because it's about the deen. So therefore he said, check who you take the deen from. He didn't say, check who you take the ilm. Because since this is the knowledge that enables us to worship Allah with, so is a deen, he become a deen. So you got to check who you take your deen from, ya ibadallah. When you sit, don't just sit and give up, say, yeah, he's a brother, man, he's been a Muslim, been way ahead of me. He must be right. Take notes. Check what is right. Listen to the statements of the people of knowledge, barakallahu fikum. So by doing this, by knowing the principles of the ibadah, you will know that anyone who went against the wishes legislated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is batil, is falsehood. Even if that person claimed that he's doing it for Allah. Because this is the excuse of Ibadallah. They claim that they're doing the first excuse when you ask him, why are you doing this, ya akhi? He said, for Allah. MashaAllah. And so he can get me closer to Allah. But in reality, anything that is not done from the legislation, he won't get those people nothing but further away from Allah. Even though they claim, Sheikh Fawzan said, even though they claim that they're doing it only to get closer to Allah, but in reality it takes them away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala simply because this is not what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated. The only thing they're going to get us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is by us applying that which Allah commanded us with and staying away from innovations. This Shaykh al-Fawzan said, إِنَّ الْعِبَادَ الَّتِي شَرَعَهَا اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى تَنْبَنِي عَلَىٰ أُصُولٍ وَأُسُسٍ ثَابِتَةَ اللَّهَ خَصُ فِي مَيَالِهِ. Now it's very, very important. It's even getting more important now. It's been getting more, even more important and more detailed. The Shaykh said, this worship that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated for us is built upon principles and fundamentals that are strong, solid, firm. This worship that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us with, and He created us for, this is why we're here on this life of earth, on earth. This worship is built and stands upon firm, solid principles and fundamentals. The Shaykh said, we summarize them in 6 points. We will summarize them for you in 6 points. أولا العبادة توقيفية. مهم جدا. العبادة توقيفية. The عبادة is worship, that we worship Allah with, is توقيفية, is endowed. What that mean? أنه لا مجال للرأي فيها, بل لا بد أن يكون المشرع لها هو الله سبحانه وتعالى. This means that there is no room for opinions. There is no room for, I think so, I guess, perhaps, it looks like, there's no room. This term should not be on our tongues. Should be erased from our dialogue and our conversation when it comes to being asked about questions of ibadah and questions of worship. There is no, I guess, it doesn't bother you, it's not a big deal. No, it is a big deal. Something that you think is going to get you closer to Allah, but in reality, keep you further away from Allah. If it's not a big deal, what is the big deal then? So know first that this ibadah is endowed. This worship is endowed, meaning لا معنى للرأي. There is no opinions of man in the ibadah, in worship. Rather, the legislation should come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The sole legislator of all these actions of ibadah is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not the brother imam so and so. Not a group of some Muslims here somewhere, so on, we're in America. It's kind of like, you know, Allah is forgiven, most forgiven, most merciful. If we just slightly change a little bit, ain't gonna hurt nobody. Inshallah. La. We have to understand, it's very important, that this ibadah is endowed. No room for opinions of men. And that the legislator is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Surah Hud, ayah 112, فَاسْتَقِمْ كَمَا أُمِرْتَ وَمَنْ سَابَ مَعَكُمْ وَلَا تَطْغَوْا. And then be upright as you were commanded. Allahu Akbar. Be upright as you've been commanded. Not as you choose to. Be upright as you've been commanded. You and those who turn to their Lord from those who repent from kufr and disbelief and they accept the tawheed and do not transgress the boundaries of Allah. Do not transgress that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set for you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Jathiyah, in Ayah 18, ثم جعلناك على شريعة من الأمر فاتبعها ولا تتبع أهواء الذين لا يعلمون. Then we have put you, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, on a plain way of our commandments, like the one which we commanded our messengers before you, all these legal ways and laws of the Islamic monotheism. So, what is our obligation towards this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, so follow you that Islamic monotheism and its laws, and follow not the desires of those who know not. And follow not the desires of those who know not. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, أو قال الله على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في سورة الأحقاف, آية 9, إن أتبع إلا ما يوحى إلي. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, that which Allah narrates for us from the Quran, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, Rather I follow that which is revealed to me from my Lord. But when the kuffar, they used to come to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and try to bribe him, try to bring some doubts and confusion about inviting him to fall into some ways of worship, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he limited himself to that which to the revelation. In attabi'u illa ma yuha ilay. I rather I'm following that which is revealed to me only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's the first principle of ibadah, that ibadah tawqifiyya, that is endowed, there is no room for opinion. You know something with certainty, bring it to the table. You don't know, say what? Say, Allahu A'lam. I do not know, inshallah. If I know, I give back with you. And go ask the people of knowledge, if you don't know, barakallahu fi. This is the attitude. This is the safe way and this is the correct way. None of us should be a hero, try to make himself a reputation in the dunya, and then that reputation here is getting him closer to his destruction in the hereafter. ثانيا, number two from these principles that this ibadah, this worship is established upon, these firm principles, لا بد أن تكون العبادة خالية من الشرك. That this worship has to be shirk free, free from all types of shirk and polytheism. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Kahf, ayah 110, the last ayah, فمن كان يرجو لقاء ربه فليعمل عملا صالحا ولا يشرك بعبادة ربه أحدا. So whoever hopes in the meeting of his Lord, let him do actions of righteousness. Is that enough? لا, it's not enough. Allah said, let him do actions of righteousness, and do not ascribe partners to his Lord. See, it's very important. Not just do righteous actions, because those people who call upon graves, they pray too. When you say to them, why you call upon the grave? They said, that's the only thing you see. I pray. I fast. I don't harm nobody. As Imam Al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala said. Imam Al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, if you were to ask those people who they worship graves, they go to a grave and say, oh, Siti Zainab, oh, Abd al-Qadir al-Jilani, oh, Ya Hussein, Ya Hassan, Ya Fatima, Ya Hussein, or so and so, they're going upon graves, and dead people in the graves. If you were to say to them, this is wrong, why are you doing this? They say, I didn't do no wrong. I'm not wronging nobody. I don't kill nobody. I don't cheat nobody. I don't abuse nobody. And the Sheikh Al-Bani said, they are liars. They say they're not oppressing nobody, but they're oppressing their own selves. They don't do no harm to nobody, they're harming their own selves. They don't cause no wrong to nobody, but they're doing wrong to their own selves by following ways, by ascribing partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Shaykh al-Fawzan said, فَإِنْ خَالَطَ الْعِبَادَ شَيْءٌ مِنَ الشِّرْكِ أَبْطَلَهَا كما قال تعالى في سورة الأنعام. The Shaykh said, if shirk is mixed with worship, he will make it void and he nullifies it. The young brothers, you three over there, excuse me, you three of you, come over here. Come on. All of you, three of you, come here, come in front of me, inshallah. تقدم بارك, so you may benefit, inshallah. Come on. You sit over there, you sit here. طيب. Move over, بارك الله. Come here, brother, here. I'm going to ask questions too, especially you three, inshallah, so pay attention. So he said, if the ibadah is mixed with shirk, the ibadah is gone, is void, is nullified, wal-iyad billah. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-An'am, ayah 88, وَلَوْ أَشْرَكُوا لَحَبِطَ عَنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. And if they would to ascribe partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship, all that which they used to do will be void. Will be void. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Az-Zumar, the two ayat 65 and 66, وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَتَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ بَلِ اللَّهَ فَاعْبُدْهُ فَاعْبُدْ وَكُنْ مِنَ الشَّاكِرِينَ. And indeed, it has been revealed to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as it was to those who came before you, meaning Allah's messenger that came before him, if you join others in worship with Allah, then surely all your deeds will be in vain, and you will certainly be among the losers. Nay, but worship Allah alone and none else, and be among the grateful. It's very important. Second point, that we have to not mix our worship with shirk. But if we don't know what shirk is, we may fall into it not knowing what is shirk. So therefore it is important to know the shirk. And the point after point, every one of us here can ask himself the same question, what I'm doing? Why are we complaining? I'm bored, I got nothing to do, man, my life is kind of like this, and I got a lot of times in my hand, I'm bored. SubhanAllah, do we know these things? Do we know the shirk? Do we know the ibadah? All of us here memorized the Quran and finished it? All of us speak Arabic fluently. All of us know in details with the Adillah, the Ibadah, the Tawheed. All of us now, if somebody come and ask us a question in Tawheed with the Dalil, can we all present the evidence? If someone come here and say to us, your Salat is all wrong, all of you here in this masjid, the Salat is wrong, rather the Salat is like this, are we going to follow him? We're going to say, la, la, what you talking about is wrong. Because we were praying, because come here, قال رسول الله, قال رسول الله, قال رسول الله, قال أبو هريرة, قال جابر, قال عائشة. Can we? Are we in this position? If we're not, so why are we wasting a lot of time? Why are we getting in the face of one another? Why can't we sit down and work together and study these basics? These are basics that are laid down in the books. Why can't we sit down and learn this thing and teach it to the children, to the youth? No, because we don't want to do that. Talisman, the third principle, and a solid and firm principle that the ibadah is built upon and laid on. لا بد أن يكون القدوة في العبادة والمبين لها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. That the example that should be followed in worship. And the one who should make it clear for us is the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. When it comes to any point of ibadah, any point of ibadah, our example in it, the way we should do it and why we should do it, is the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Nobody else. Yes, you follow your brother Imam, but as long as he following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If the brother Imam is on another program, leave him on his program. You got to be in the program of this man, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Don't be naive, brother. Don't say, no, but I know the brother for the past 30 years. I don't think he's going to like cheat us. I don't think after all this he is going to like and lure us and push us to the hellfire. He's a good brother. How do you know, brother? If you know the truth. If you know the true ibadah, how this man Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did it, then if your brother Imam doing it the way that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did it, alhamdulillah, you got yourself a good brother. A good brother Imam. But if he's doing it somewhere, some other way other than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, You just have to say, I cannot be with you, man. I cannot follow you on that. Because there is only one man that I was commanded to follow. And what is the proof to this? Here is the proof, barakallahu fikum. Proofs are many, but I will give you just two proofs from the Quran. The first proof is the ayah 21 in Surah Al-Ahzab. Right? The ayah 21. What's the ayah number, akhi? 21, barakallahu fikum. Ayah 21 in Surah? In Surah? Al-Ahzab. Be with me, Akhi. Alright? What's your name? Yaqeen? Allahu Akbar. You know what I mean? Servant. And we're talking about that. What's your name? Ali. Saleh? Saeed? MashaAllah. You know what I mean, Saeed? Happy. You want to be happy in this life and hereafter? And this is the way. This is something that's going to keep you and all of us, inshallah ta'ala, happy, inshallah. All right, brother? Brother Yaqeen? Allahu Akbar. Yaqeen. It's a heavy name, akhi. Right? You're ready for the challenge. So now whatever you do, you got to have some Yaqeen. That's your name to remind you. Ali. Ayyub? So in the ayah 21 of Surah Al-Ahzab, Allah Ta'ala said, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. Indeed, you have in the Messenger of Allah. In the Messenger of Allah, a good example to be followed. Alright? Not in the brother, imam, or the administration, or the da'i, so-and-so. No. Indeed, you have in the Messenger of Allah a good example to be followed. Once again, those people who, after the Prophet ﷺ, his companions, the people who come after, the ulama, the du'a, the imams, the administrators, if they follow in this man Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we follow them. If we know they follow in something else, we don't follow them in that. We try to do our best to correct them, inshallah, in a good way, in good manners. The second proof is the ayah number 7 in Surah Al-Hashr, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا. Whatsoever, don't be picky when it comes to the deen, because Allah said, whatsoever this man Muhammad, the messenger of Allah, has given you, take it. Whatsoever he forbade you, stay away from it. Don't be picky in the deen. I'm in America, I take only this. When I'm in Saudi, I'm going to do this. Well, when I was in Egypt, I was doing it. Now I'm in Manhattan, I'm in Kansas, I can't do this. Be picky. The ayah said, didn't say whatever the messenger gave you when you're in Saudi, take it. Whatever the messenger of Allah gave you, take it completely. Whatever he forbade you from, stay away from it. And in the end of the day, who's the beneficial? Who's going to benefit from all this? It's me and you. As we mentioned in the beginning, the Sheikh Fawzan said, it's you, ayat Allah. If you do this, you're going to benefit. You're going to benefit. And it's amazing, with certain people, some of us, we're not even doing the basics are right. Our basic elementary knowledge in the deen ain't straight. Many of us don't even know how to make the wudu properly. Or they make the wudu, if you just ask them if this is the right way, and they be puzzled, they be like, no yaqeen, no certainty. Many of us, do we know, yes, this is salah, I pray, Allahu Akbar, salah, Allahu Akbar, ruku, sujood. Do I have certainty and knowledge from the legislation that this is the only way the prayer should be done? And if just in case somebody may come and try to take me away from that, I'm like, no, not me. Try somebody else. Since this is the case of the majority of the Muslims, as Imam Al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala said, the majority of the Muslims ibadallah are like this. Why to blame others? Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, he refuted those people, the Khawarij, who they just blame the rulers, he said, subhanallah, they want from the rulers to be like Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman, but they are not like the rest of the companions that Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman ruled over. See, they want the rulers of today to be like Abu Bakr or like Uthman. So what about them? Are they in a level where the people who Umar and Abu Bakr was ruling over? La ya, wah, you gotta be just. The point I'm making here is that we have to concern ourselves. Every one of us should sit by himself and say, well, what am I doing this for, ya Abdullah? Like Sheikh Rabi'a would say, what am I doing this for? For show up? For reputation? To be said, this is the wrong path. But if I'm doing it because I want to do, I have to do it first because this is a command from Allah, and I'm doing it because I want to get closer to Allah, and therefore be admitted to His Jannah and saved from the fire, then I have to do it the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants me to do it. And once I know, then I look at the people close to me first and try to help them out, inshallah ta'ala. Not once I know, I start making fun and a mockery of those who don't know. This is not from the adab, ya ibadallah. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كما في مسلم من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد. He's more food than lectures. MashaAllah. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, whoever does an action that is not from our command and our affairs, it will be rejected. Okay. This is a clear text. All those who they do certain things that are not according to the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, guess what, brother and sister? Go ahead, do whatever you want to do. Increase from those actions. Rahamukallah. My prophet and your prophet that you believe is the prophet, he's saying that he's going to be rejected. وفي رواية متفق عليها من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه فهو رد. In another narration that is agreed upon by Imam al-Bukhari and Imam Muslim from the way of Aisha radiallahu anha, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and whoever introduced to this deen a matter that is not from it, it will be rejected. It is rejected, no doubt, ya ibadallah. وقوله صلى الله عليه وسلم, another proof is a statement of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in the hadith that is agreed upon by Imam al-Bukhari and Imam Muslim, صلوا كما رأيتموني أصلي. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم say, pray as you have seen me pray. See, they say, go ahead, صلوا, it's okay, leave him pray. You brother just want to cause a fitna, يا أخي, subhanAllah. It's not a big deal. The man, he prays to his Lord. He prays standing, sitting. He prays 5 rak'ah, 3 rak'ah. That's not the main. The issue is the heart. Okay, come on. You guys want to divide the people. Allah Akbar. We're going to say this is not right. Pray as you have seen me praying, Ya Ibad Allah. إلى غير ذلك من النصوص الدالة على وجوبي الاقتداء برسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم دون سواه. And this is only, هذا ما هو إلا غيظ من خير. It's not just a little bit from Allah and a lot of proofs, texts from the Quran and the Sunnah. They all show the obligation, not the choice. The obligation that is obligatory to follow the Islam Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم and not to follow other than him. رابعا, number 4 from those solid and firm fundamentals and principles that this عبادة worship is laid upon, أن العبادة محدودة بمواقيت ومقادير لا يجوز تعديها وتجاوزها. That this عبادة that we're doing is limited by the legislation, is limited to a specific time and a specific ways and specific amounts. It is not permissible for anyone to change the time, to increase the number, decrease it, or change the way that this ibadah is worshipped and should be performed. For example, as-salat. As-salat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah An-Nisa, ayah 103, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ كَانَتْ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا. Indeed, the salah was prescribed upon the believers at fixed times. No one should just take it upon himself. Say, we're in America, I gotta go to work. It's okay for me. When I come back from work, I just pray everything together. Says, who, Ya Abdullah? Where is your text? قُلْ هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. Say, bring your proofs if you are truthful. Or somebody may come and say, listen, man, this is a summer. This just combine all the salawat at the whole time and this it's okay. Says who? Yeah, the imam got no problem with it. The administration agreed on it. Yeah, so what's the big deal? Who are you? You're not the imam. You're not the administration. Why are you interfering in the business of the community? This is not a community business. This is the deen, Ya Abdullah. This is the deen, barakallahu feek. Likewise, al-hajj. Al-hajj ashhur al-ma'lumat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said al-hajj should be performed in well-known months. And where the Muslims go for hajj? Where we go for hajj? Huh? Mecca. Mecca and Mina, Muzdalifa and Arafat. That's the hajj. Mecca, Mina, Muzdalifa, Arafat. It's rough in there. It's very hot, especially in the summer. The desert. Can this a group of some Muslims now may say, hold on. We've been going to Mecca for many years. Let's go to the Caribbean next year for a change. We're going to make a hajj in the Caribbean. We're going to put a Kaaba right there, everything. And we're going to make the hajj in the Caribbean. We're going to get a lot of people. We go there? Or Cancun? Look at that. Can't do that. Why can't we do it? Why? Who knows the answer? Ya Allah Ali, why can't we go to the Caribbean for Hajj? It's bid'ah, ahsant. Allahu Akbar. It's an innovation. Why? Simply because the innovation is something that is introduced to the deen. And it was not in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From that fasting, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, شهر رمضان في سورة البقرة آية 185, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل به القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان فمن شهد منكم الشهر، شوف فمن شهد ما قال اختار أي شهرا، فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصم. الله سبحانه وتعالى said the month of Ramadan in which the Quran was revealed as guidance to mankind and a clear proof from guidance and a divider between the truth and falsehood. So whoever amongst you witnessed this month of Ramadan, he didn't say any month, this month of Ramadan, let him fast the month of Ramadan. Okay, you know how the month of Ramadan, the year rotate, the Arabic calendar rotates around the other one. And now, Ramadan, in a couple years, is going to come in August, July, and you'll be fasting 17 hours in the heat. Somebody may say, oh, no, no. Let's just fix it in January, man. 8 hours, man, smooth, nice. Sleep, wake up at the adhan of the Maghrib. Oh, yeah. Oh, man, subhanAllah, why we didn't think about this? See? Those who are in their hearts is a disease, they don't know nothing about the deen, they're going to say, man, subhanAllah, at least we have a smart one among us. Man, why didn't we think, why were we going through all this hardship, and we couldn't even, how stupid we are indeed. How couldn't we just get to the, to just, subhanAllah, it's 1 month, a month is not a problem, 30 days. Is this right? Say, is it right to move Ramadan and put it in January, fix it in January? Like the Nation of Islam did, not Islam, Islam. Like the Farahanists, those who follow Farahan, not those who follow Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I don't know if they're still doing it, whatever. They fixed the first thing in what? In December. And where did they bring this from? How long are their desires, wal-iyadu billah? By the way, they're not even Muslims, so we don't even have to worry about them. فَلَا تَصِحُ هَذِهِ الْعِبَادَةِ أَدَاءً فِي غَيْرِ وَقْتِهَا. So all this ibadat and acts of worship, they're not correct if they are not done in their proper times, the way that they are performed by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They are not, if anybody does something else, they're not accepted. خَامِسًا, number five, لابد أن تكون العبادة قائمة على محبة الله تعالى والذل له وخوفه ورجائه. That this ibadah now that you know you gotta do it, you gotta follow the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, it's free from shirk. You know that it's limited to a certain way, a certain times, a number, and the like, and this and this and places. Then now you have to do it out of love. Doing it, loving to do it, not pushed to it. Not just because your father pray, and if you don't pray, you're going to get in trouble. Or maybe you're around brothers, they call the iqama, now you don't even have wudu. Some people like that. You don't want to feel like the only one left not praying. You're doing out of love to humble yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Out of love, humility for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Feeling the punishment of Allah, hoping in a reward that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have in for those people who perform these actions of worship. فعلامات محبة الله. Now somebody may say, okay, I want to do it. There's no problem with that. I want to do it for the love of Allah. But how, what is the sign? How a person know that he's doing this out of love, but not for shawab or for something else. فعلامات محبة الله اتباع الرسول أولا. From the signs of love, doing this act of worship, out of love for Allah, is following the messenger. That's the first thing. Somebody who is not following the messenger, he can claim any love he wants. وَطَاعَةِ اللَّهِ وَطَاعَةِ الرَّسُولِ. And fall on obedience to Allah and obedience to His messenger. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, in Surah Ali Imran, ayah 31, قل إن كنتم تحبون الله إيش فاتبعوني يحببكم الله. Say to them, O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, if you claim as you claim that you love Allah, what is the test? Then follow me. Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Then follow me, Allah will love you and forgive you your sins. The people of Allah, they say Allah will love only those who they follow the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And only those who are truthful in their claim, saying that they love the Prophet, the Allah, Only those who follow the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Those who don't follow the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and innovate, they can claim all they want. These are people that don't love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَثَمَرَاتُهَا And what is the fruits of this mahabba? The fruits of this mahabba is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love you in the end of the ayah. And Allah will forgive you your sins. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِ That's the sharp. And what is نهي الثمرة؟ فَاتَّبِعُونِ يَحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ So say if you love Allah, now that's your claim, you love Allah, what is the, how you prove it? Then follow the Messenger of Allah. Okay, now you pass this test, Alhamdulillah, you said you love Allah, you follow the Prophet ﷺ, you're truthful in your claim. What is the result of this and the fruits of this? Allah will love you and forgive you your sins. Allah Akbar. Allah will love you and forgive you your sins. Sadis and lastly, the last point, أن العبادة لا تسقط عن المكلف من بلوغه عاقلا إلى وفاته. That this ibadah, this worship, is obligatory upon the mukallaf. No one who, when he reached the age of puberty and responsibility, no one is exempt from this ibadah until he dies. Someone who reached the age of puberty, the age of discernment, and he is sane, he is a saint, so therefore this worship is upon him and her until they die. There is no offer. Oh, you run out of luck. 10 years of worship. So it's no one. Says who? Administration. I never heard this, but it may happen. It may happen. This brother gives donations, a lot of donations in the masjid. You don't have to come for Salat al-Fajr. So okay, I get you. Get some rest. You work hard and you bring the money to the community. We may start hearing these things, huh? What are we going to say? We're going to say, la, 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 la. From the fundamentals, that is, this ibadah is worshipped upon, that is established upon, that every responsible saint who is the age of discernment is not exempt until he dies, or she dies. What is the proof? You know the proof? Who knows the proof? Is the ayah in Surah Al-Nahl, وَعْبُدْ رَبَّكَ حَتَّى يَأْتِيكَ الْيَقِينَ And worship your Lord until death comes to you. This yaqeen, certainty here, the people of knowledge, they say, death. And worship your Lord until death comes to you. وَعْبُدْ رَبَّكَ حَتَّى يَأْتِيكَ الْيَقِينَ The other ayah is, in Surah Al-Imran, وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ And die not except in a state of Islam. And how a person can guarantee that he worship Allah only on for 10 years and 50 years after that or 30 years he's a fasik, he don't pray, no fast, zina, fornication and die on that. How he gonna think that he died on Islam? As we were in Umrah, the Shaykh Umar Bazmul, Hafidahullah Ta'ala, was explaining this ayah, it was very beneficial talk as well. It was like two, three weeks ago. And by the way, the mashayikh, they give you the salam to all the brothers and the sisters in America, alhamdulillah, the Muslims and the Muslimat. And he said that from the ways that the divine groups, they play with the meanings of the ayats. Like the Sufis, for example. He said the Sufis, they take this ayah, وَعْبُدْ رَبَّكَ حَتَّى يَأْتِيَكَ الْيَقِينَ The Sufis, they take this ayah and worship your Lord until certainty come to you. The people of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they say certainty here is death. Because death is certain. Worship your Lord until death comes to you. Even in a deathbed, somebody in a coma, man, but he woke up, he's going to say, La ilaha illallah, astaghfirullah. He regained his faculties, somebody's going to be there saying, oh, you're talking now? Say La ilaha illallah, worship your Lord. Until he dies. And therefore you see the mistakes that Shaykh Al-Uthaymeen said, I'm going to go back to the statement of Omar Bazmoor. Shaykh Al-Uthaymeen said you see the mistakes of certain people, that when somebody amongst them is sick and ill, they say, oh, don't pray, leave him alone. Come on, yaakhi, that's not us. He prayed, shouldn't pray, man, no, he's sick, he prayed later on, no, that's a mistake. He prays, but according to his position, to his situation. Everyone, there is no hardship in this deen. Sheikh Omar Bazlul said the Sufis, they have another interpretation to this word certainty. They say certainty here is a level that their main people reach. Like their imam, the Sufi imam, he prays, fast, make hajj, he shouldn't fornicate, shouldn't smoke, shouldn't listen to music, shouldn't backbite, shouldn't do this, shouldn't commit adultery, shouldn't look at the haram, huh? Right? Should abide by the commands of Allah, stay away from his prohibitions. Until he reached this certainty, now it's okay for him to do whatever he wants to do. Can anybody imagine this, Ibadallah? They say, so now he reached this level, he can fornicate, commit adultery, smoke reefer, drink alcohol, eat pork, no pray, no fasting, no hajj, no haram, no halal, all the same. Why? Because he raised this certainty. What is your proof, Sufi?
Oh, the ayah in the Quran, I'abud rabbaka worship your Lord at the certainty complete.
The Sheikh said he was in one of those Asian countries, the Sheikh himself said, I don't know if he's him or one of the mashayikh, the scholars, that narrated to him, I don't remember now. But that's what he said. He said, they were in this Asian country, giving da'wah, teaching the people the proper Islam. And he said, they were in this masjid, and they saw this guy, butt naked, smoking in the masjid. The Sheikh said, bro, who's that? The Sheikh said, who's that? They said, no, that's Mawlana. That's the main man in our community. Why he's naked and smoking in a place of worship? No. The plan is lifted upon this person. Why? He reached the certainty. Allah. هل بعد هذا الدلال من دلال؟ Is there any دلال and misguided after this? اللهم استعان. أقول قولي وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. This is, inshallah, we're going to come to an end. Don't want to make it too long for you, brothers and sisters. May Allah benefit us from this. Remember, Ya Akhwan, these points of Aqeedah, these points say that the Ibadah is laid upon, Barakallahu Fikum. Let's all of us put it to practice. Let's all of us check our Ibadah and our worship, because that's you and me that we're going to stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we're not going to blame it on nobody. Yes, follow your brother Imam now, but you cannot blame it on him on Yawm al-Qiyamah. Follow the administration, cannot blame it on them on Yawm al-Qiyamah. Follow your father, if you want to, upon that falsehood. If your father on Yawm al-Qiyamah say, who are you? I don't know you, man. Huh? Everybody's gonna free themselves on Yawm al-Qiyamah from everybody else. Everybody say myself. هذا صلى الله وسلم على محمد على آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Let's stop there. I want to